Welcome to the channel. My name is Robert Hoffmeyer. If you're new here, we do African wildlife filmmaking content, as well as some camping, overlanding, 4x4ing, that sort of thing. In the last video, we imported a Starlink kit from Australia into South Africa, set it up and strapped it to the roof of the 4x4 to test how well it would work in motion while on bumpy roads. So I was about to then chop up that Starlink dish to flat mount it permanently and do a 12-volt conversion when Starlink announced their Gen 3 kits. Actually, technically, they're Gen 4 kits, I believe, but everyone's calling them Gen 3, so I will do the same. So the Gen 3 is already flat and it comes with a separate power adapter, so it's much easier to convert to run off 12 volts. So I decided rather to sell the Gen 2 to my brother and wait for the Gen 3. The Gen 3s became available in the US in December and I immediately purchased one, only to discover that Starlink had changed their terms and conditions and required a 120-day wait between purchase and transfer of a kit. So I can't now transfer it from my US account to my African account for 120 days. This isn't the end of the world, because if I do need it desperately, I can always activate global roaming on my US account and it will work here. It's just that'll cost quite a lot of money. So anyhow, today the kit arrived from the US. I had to use a forwarding address. Starlink won't ship to you directly, so I used myus.com in the United States and shipped from Starlink to there, and then they shipped it to me. As you can see, the Starlink, the actual area of the dish is quite large, quite a bit larger than the Gen 2, but it is substantially thinner. The Gen 2's box is at least 30 centimeters deep because of the pole. So what we're gonna do in this video is we're going to make a vehicle mount for this dish. We're going to use Starlink's pole mount and modify it so we can mount the dish on my roof rack. But before that, let's open this up and have a look what's inside. Okay, let's see. How do we open this thing? It's got these kind of pull tab things. I don't know what you call these. Got one on that side, one on the bottom, and one over here. Then I think, there we go. Ooh, here is the dish itself, quite a bit larger than the Gen 2, but significantly flatter. Comes with a plastic kickstand, but these new mounts easily clip on and off. That's why I bought the cast aluminium pole mount, which I'll use to mount the dish to the vehicle. It'll be very easy then to just pop the dish off, pop the kickstand back on if I want to mount it on the ground or on a table or whatever, where it has a clear view of the sky. Let's move that aside, get some instructions. There, very, very simple. The router is now Wi-Fi 6 and it comes with a couple of extra ports over there. The power adapter is very simple. It has a barrel connector, a 5521, I believe, barrel connector. Very common, very easy to convert to 12 volts. The power cable has a US plug at the moment. I'll chop that off and put a South African one. And on the other end, it has a very standard, I call that a radio plug, but not sure what it actually is called. Then comes with, I believe, a 15 meter cable, but this cable is now standard. So you can very easily pop into a computer shop and get any Cat 6 shielded cable and use that to connect the router and the dish. So I'll probably permanently mount maybe a 5 meter cable running from my roof rack into the vehicle. Yeah, so that's what you get in the kit. This is the rear of the dish. As you can see, it's quite angular. It looks like they took their design cues from the Tesla Cybertruck. I think they also copied Tesla's panel alignment skills, because the rear and side of this dish have a gap of about half a millimeter at every corner, but they're flush along the edges. I'm hoping that's just a cosmetic issue and that it won't allow water to get in or something. So let's pop out the kickstand, and this is the pole mount that I also purchased from Starlink. As a pole mount, I'd be a little bit nervous. This recess into which the pole fits is very shallow. It's only about 15 millimeters deep. So I'd be a bit worried that the pole would come loose, but we're not using for that, so no worries. And it is nice cast aluminium, I think. It locks in very securely. And then I purchased a metal plate with lots of holes in it from the hardware store. I had to cut it so it had four holes at each end. And the plan is to pop rivet this onto the rear of the pole mount. Then I'm going to use those four holes at each end to attach some small brackets on each side. And I had some 25mm square pipe lying around, so I chopped two lengths of this. The distance between those holes matches the spacing of my roof rack. These will then be riveted onto each side of the plate, and then the entire thing can be attached to the roof rack. The idea is to make a kind of H-shaped bracket with this plate at a bit of an angle, so that when the pipe mount is attached, the dish sits level. Okay, the vehicle mount is done. It's not the most beautiful thing I've ever made, but it will serve its purpose. So here's the idea. It gets bolted onto the roof rack at all four corners. So this is secure on the vehicle. Then when we need internet in or near the vehicle, we just obviously plug the cable into this and then slot it onto the top and lock it into place. You can see the underside there, and when we are done, we pop this thing off and stow the dish in the vehicle. I'm also going to quickly try out some magnetic feet for when I need to use this on vehicles that don't have roof racks. So I've got some of these rubber coated magnetic discs on Amazon. I want to attach these now to each of the four corners, but I don't want them to be totally rigid because vehicles often have a curve to them. So I want these to be able to move slightly without being too loose. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use some rubber washers for tap, they're standard tap washers. I'm going to position them like so, and then another rubber washer on top and a metal washer just to make sure it can't slip out. And I can then screw this entire thing on and make sure it's nice and tight. There we go. So now it has got a little bit of give, but not too much. There we go. Okay, let's go test it on the car. Oh dear, look at my poor Barry. Had a bit of an accident. Okay. So, if we were to want to mount it to the bonnet, I would just pop it down. The magnets are pretty strong. That's a decent amount of strength. You can lift if you go from one side you can pop it up, but direct upward pressure, it's very strong. Then we simply clip on the dish and we're good to go. Look at that, looks quite neat actually. It's getting a bit messy around here. I realized that it's got a bit of give between the pole mount and the dish, so I decided to print some spacers that would take up the space between the dish and the legs here and just make the whole thing a bit more solid. Let's have a look here. It's nearly done. There we go. The idea is that these spacers sit between the legs and the dish. There'll be four of them, and they'll reduce any play between the mount and the dish. So everything seems to be working nicely on the vehicle mount. I've just taken it apart quickly because I'm going to give this a quick sand and a coat of spray paint just to make it look a little bit neater. Interestingly, I was just reading that Starlink is now recalling this pipe mount. They didn't say why, but I assume it's because this recess is so shallow. Luckily, that's something that doesn't affect what we're doing here. Maybe they'll even refund me my $35. We'll see. So the vehicle mount is complete. I bolted it down to the roof rack, and as you can see, I've also added these spacers so the dish sits more firmly. I've run the cable up and it goes through this hole at the back of the mount. Now all we need to do, I've asked Andy to come around and give me a hand. Do you mind filming a bit, Andy?
Sure.
Thank you. So now what we do is we plug the cable into the back of the dish first, then the dish slots onto the mount and locks into place.
Boom!
Boom!
You're managing there, Andy?
Yeah. Haven't driven Barry for a while.
Yeah. Don't drive into a tree, eh?
Yeah. I believe your wife did that.
Yeah, my wife drove Barry into a tree in our driveway right here and caused a bit of damage. I had to buy him new tires to make him feel better. It's a rainy day in Hermanus. Andy's taking us for a little drive. And everything is set up, I think. I've just put that's the power adapter over there. That's the Starlink router over there. Everything is plugged in. This cable runs up and out to the dish, which is on the roof of the vehicle. And then all I need to do is turn on the inverter, in theory, and that should boot up the router and the dish. And it'll take about 5 minutes, but it should connect to the internet. Let's see. Once the system is booted, you can connect to the Starlink Wi-Fi. And then I'm going to open the Starlink app to check that everything is working. Okay, the dish has come alive. You'll see it over there. And it is currently searching for satellites. It does say determining alignment. Adjustment may be necessary in a moment for best performance. But obviously, if it's mounted on the roof rack of a vehicle, adjustment is not possible. So we'll have to take what we can get. that took a while because it seemed it had to download an update or something, but we seem to be online now. We're driving at about 40 kilometers an hour. We're gonna do a quick speed test. And there we go, 220 megabits per second download, 214 milliseconds latency, and about 10 megabit per second upload. Not bad at all. All right, so I'm happy with those results. It seems to work really well. We still need to test it in a real life situation, in the heat, on the bumpy roads, etc. Long term, I think it'll work, and I think it's going to really be a very useful tool for us in our work. Yeah, catch you next time. Bye bye.
Cheers, cheers.